Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. My name is Dr. Tossin and today I'm going to be talking about fibroids. So if you're watching this video, you've probably heard about fibroids or it's something that you're currently dealing with. It can cause a lot of stress and anxiety, particularly if you have heavy and painful periods which are not responding to normal medical management, or you're worried that the fibroids may affect your fertility or your chances of becoming pregnant. So in this video, I'm going to be talking about what causes fibroids, the relationship between fibroid and infertility, and what can be done to manage it. So fibroids are basically benign growth, which means non-cancerous growth within the womb. They are very common, and it's thought that 50 to 70% of women will develop at least one fibroid during their lifetime. The exact cause of fibroids still remains largely unknown. It's thought that the hormone called estrogen plays an important role, which is why fibroids is more common in women of reproductive age and less common in women who have undergone the menopause. So there are a number of different risk factors which can predispose people to getting fibroid. Some of this risk factor is related to how long you've been exposed to estrogen. So obviously if you start your period at an earlier age or you're at an older age at the time of your first pregnancy, that can increase your chance. Other risk factors include obesity, high blood pressure, diabetes, and you also may have heard that fibroids is more common in black people. Although it's not well understood why this is the case, it's thought that genetic factors as well as environmental factors may play an important role in this. So in terms of genetic factors, if you have family members who have fibroids, you're more at risk of developing it. And one of the environmental factors which is currently being looked into is vitamin D deficiency. Some studies have shown that low levels of vitamin D may increase the chance of getting fibroids. And although the studies are not completely conclusive, it may account for some of the reasons why black people are more at risk of getting fibroids than other ethnicities. So obviously we have a darker skin complexion and as a result are less likely to be able to make vitamin D from direct sunlight. So how do you know whether you've got fibroids? Some patients have no symptoms at all, so they're called asymptomatic and therefore don't really know about it. Other patients may develop symptoms like heavy, painful periods, and some patients may develop compressive symptoms. So your womb is very close to other organs such as your bowel and your bladder. And if the fibroid is large, it can compress those organs and cause things like constipation and the frequent need to urinate. So before we talk about how fibroids are managed and how it may be related to infertility, it's important to talk about the different types of fibroids. So the first type of fibroid is called subserosal, where the fibroid is attached to the outer wall of the womb. The second type is called intermural, where the fibroid is attached to the inner muscular part of the womb. And the third type is called submucosal, where the fibroid is attached in the inner lining of the womb. So how does fibroids affect fertility? So before we talk about this, it's important to know that having fibroids does not necessarily mean infertility. A lot of women have fibroids and are able to conceive naturally and able to have successful pregnancies. And fibroids only account for 2-3% of all causes of infertility, which is pretty low. However, the size and the location of the fibroids does matter. In terms of the size, obviously if the fibroid is quite large, that can change the shape of the uterus and therefore affect a fertilized egg from implanting. Also, even if the fertilized egg does implant and it implants close to a fibroid, this can affect the growth of the embryo and that can cause miscarriage. So apart from the size, location is actually shown to matter even more. Studies have shown that patients who have subserosal fibroids, so fibroids on the outer wall of the womb, and patients who have no fibroids at all are at a similar chance of getting pregnant. Whereas those patients who have intermural, which is fibroids in the inner wall, or submucosal, fibroids attached to the inner lining of the womb, are more at risk of having issues getting pregnant because there's more likely to be a change or distortion to the shape of the uterus, which can affect implantation. So what can be done to manage fibroids, and what can be done if you're trying to get pregnant and you have fibroids? So this is all patient dependent. Some patients have no symptoms at all, which means nothing needs to be done. Other patients can develop heavy, painful periods, and if that's the case, there are medical management which can be used to treat this. Part of this medical management include things like non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like mefenamic acid, which can help with painful periods. Other drugs include tranexamic acid, which can help with heavy bleeding. And other medications include hormonal contraception such as a combined pill, progesterone-only pill, and in some cases, the marinocoil. Another medication which can be used is something called gonadotropin release and hormone analog. And this is a medication which is normally prescribed by a specialist doctor, so a gynecologist. It basically works by blocking the production of estrogen and progesterone, and as a result, causes the fibroids to shrink. It's something that is only used as a short-term measure because it can cause a lot of side effects. Because of the blockage of estrogen progesterone, it can put women in a temporary menopause-like state, and it can cause severe symptoms such as hot flushes and other symptoms associated with the menopause. So it's not something that is readily prescribed, but can be used for in patients who are about to undergo surgeries who have large fibroids, because that medication can shrink the fibroid and make the surgery easier. Apart from medical management, there are surgical options. One of the surgical options is something called uterine artery embolization, where a small catheter or probe is fed through part of the arteries which supply the uterus. This artery is then blocked, and this can reduce blood flow or blood supply to the uterus or the fibroid, causing the fibroid to shrink. However, with any procedures, there are some complications, and it's something that's not recommended for patients who are trying to get pregnant because it can cause ovarian failure. The other types of surgery is something called a myomectomy, where the fibroid is removed. This can be done in three different types of way. So it can be done via hysteroscopy, where a small camera is inserted through the vagina into the womb to remove the fibroid. It can also be done laparoscopically, where small holes are inserted into the abdomen to remove the fibroid. Or it can be done opened, where a small cut is made in the abdomen to remove the fibroid. This procedure is often reserved for patients who have tried medical management and it hasn't worked, or patients who are trying to get pregnant. The last type of surgery is something called a hysterectomy, where the entire uterus as well as the fibroids are removed together. Obviously, it's not something that you would do if you're trying to get pregnant. However, it may be beneficial for women who have completed having a family and want to have a better quality of life, particularly if they're having heavy and painful periods. So guys, that's fibroids in a nutshell. I hope you guys have learned something. If you have, please make sure you like and you subscribe. And if there's any other topics you'd like me to discuss, please leave it in the comment box. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you guys have enjoyed the video. Take care. Bye.